Some artists made trees their primary focus, as seen here in the bristlecone pine print by Klaus Sievert and in the valley oak print by Terry Steinke, both contemporary California artists. Others would draw the tree in a small gathering or forest, which we will see later in the oak series by the 19th century artist Kolbe. The shape of a tree is deeply beautiful. Its shape is organic and quite varied, providing the artist a unique and inspiring challenge. In this drawing by the artist Henry Harris Lines, the artist depicts two mature oaks in early spring. Leaves have not yet emerged. The tree trunk and branch structure are the sole focus. Furthermore, trees evoke a wonderful sense of place. We would immediately recognize a redwood tree as a California fog tree and a bristlecone pine as a California mountain tree. We would surely not mix up these evergreen trees with oaks from Germany, where deciduous forests blanket the land. In this image, Reinhardt, an artist at the turn of the 19th century, depicts two enormous oaks that dwarf the mill, animals, and people. There are many decisions an artist must make. Let's take subject matter. What kind of tree should the artist select to draw or paint? Here is Nicolas Poussin's drawing, two silver birches, the front one fallen. The focus is on the more interesting of the two trees, the damaged front one. The healthy tree in the background is drawn lighter, so focus can remain on the one in front. Trees are challenging in that they live outside and are subject to the elements, changing light as the sun moves through the sky and winds that cause the tree to move unexpectedly. Monet was especially skilled in capturing both light and movement in his painting Water Lily Pond and Weeping Willow. Often, trees and landscapes are placed in a frontal plane with a straight-on view. But how should the tree be placed on the paper? In this example by Blumhardt, the tree arches diagonally across the page. The monk is a small part of the composition, but the tree, with its incredible root system, is the main event. Should the background be rendered in a context such as a landscape? Here, the artist Kolbe features a dead tree in the front plane where we focus our attention, but the context is a landscape. Some artists want to present the tree against a flat or stark background with minimal context, such as here how Winkler has done with his Sierra tree. Others yet flatten the context completely away and bring forward a decorative element, as in Klimt's Tree of Life. Can you even see the tree? Finally, the artist has choices regarding his or her drawing style. Trees provide the artist great opportunity in terms of detail. Should every minute detail of the bark, the branches and leaves be defined or merely suggested, like a blob on the horizon, as in Coleman's beautiful Windy Hill triptych? Another great artist who was more interested in expressing the essence of the tree and landscape and his emotions about it was the expressionist Kirchner. Here, in his mountain forest near Davos, realistic detail is unimportant, but rather the artist portrayed the emotion of the scene through vibrant and vivid color, not realistic detail. Should the drawing style be realistic, as in what would appear in a book describing the trees of Germany? Some artists might want to render a fantastical tree, as Kolbe did, of a dead willow trunk that has taken on the shape of an old elephant. As you have seen, there are many options and decisions an artist must make as he works through a design. Subject matter, composition, and drawing style are all key factors. Now, let's look at the 19th century etcher who specialized in trees. Carl Wilhelm Kolbe was born in Berlin in 1757, and he died in Dessau, Germany, 1835. He was the son of a German gold thread embroiderer and a French Huguenot mother. His first position upon leaving home was as a French teacher at the Dessau Language School, located 80 miles southwest of Berlin. He remained at the school for 3 years, but then moved back to Berlin as a civil servant in 1782, hoping to improve his financial prospects. Unfortunately, he hated the position and returned to the Dessau Language School 2 years later. The school was not doing well at that time, and it closed. On the encouragement of his uncle, Chodowiecki, a famous printmaker and the director of the Berlin Art Academy, Kolbe went to the academy following an interest in art and skill that he had developed since his youth. He was a bearded 30-year-old sitting among 10 and 12-year-old boys. He finished his studies quickly, returned to teaching, but in only 3 years, he became the court etcher and a drawing and French teacher at the court of Leopold von Anhalt, Dessau. Kolbe was fortunate in that he had two careers, one as a teacher and one as an artist. He taught French, which included writing a book on the richness of the French and German vocabulary. And he taught drawing, which included pupils who would later become famous romantic artists in their own right, Olivier, Runge, and Kruger. His second career was as an artist. Kolbe did not travel to Italy as other artists did, but in 1805, Kolbe left Dessau for 3 years to live in Zurich, Switzerland, and etch the unpublished gouaches of Solomon Gessner, who had passed away and who had been a source of inspiration for Kolbe in his early years. By 1810, only a few years after Kolbe's return from Switzerland, his art had fallen out of favor. His last edition of etchings found few buyers, which is in sharp contrast to today, where this print of a fantastic old tree recently fetched over 8,000 euros. Kolbe's first love was landscapes. He was an artist on the tail end of neoclassicism, where the focus was on the human form. The movement that followed, Romanticism, would pick up on Kolbe's love of nature and take it much further.